ever started a new company and feel like the most difficult task is just trying to figure out the acronyms and the nomenclature? If you're new to programming, there's going to be a lot of terms that you're not familiar with. Before we dive into this Java course, there's a few terms that I want to make you familiar with. In the Java videos, I'm assuming that you don't know anything about Java or how it works. If there's ever something unclear in the videos, feel free to post a question in the comments on dgu.com or in the Facebook group. I'm here to help you.
There's really only one goal for this tutorial. Get familiar with some of the Java terms used in this tutorial. In this lesson, I'm going to introduce you to how Java works on your machine, why it works on multiple platforms, and a few other miscellaneous terms you should know. Running a Java program is the same as running any other computer program in some ways, but in other ways, it's very different. When you run a program compiled for your computer, you are running code compiled for your computer architecture. A Mac will only run on a Mac, Windows will only run on Windows, and Linux only runs on Linux. One way we get around this is by using a virtual machine. A virtual machine is a program that emulates the behavior of a particular computer system. The advantage is that you can compile once for a virtual machine, and your program runs on any physical system the virtual machine can run on. So we are taking code, compiling it for a virtual machine, and any computer that can run the virtual machine can run your compiled code. A virtual machine reads instructions from your program and then translates it into instructions your computer can run. When you write and can compile a Java application, you are compiling it for a Java machine. Now, no one has a Java machine. We all run Macs, Linux, or Windows. Java uses something called a Java virtual machine. The Java virtual machine is also called by its initials JVM. When you install Java on a computer, you install a JVM. Java applications you create are run on the JVM, and this is how Java achieves platform independence. The basic development flow for any Java program will be to write the Java code into a text file, compile the Java code into class files, which are then fed to a JVM. The JVM interprets the class file into code your machine can understand. This is similar to any other compiled programming language. When you download a virtual machine, you're downloading the Java Runtime Environment, or JRE. The JRE contains libraries and the JVM you need to run Java programs. The JRE does not, however, contain what you need to write and debug Java programs. For that, you need the Java Development Kit. Time for a quick history lesson. Java's been around for a very long time. It was released in 1996, and it was originally called the Java Development Kit, at least for the first two versions. I've been using it since 1998 when Java 1.2 came out, and that's where it gets weird. 1.2 equals 2. That is, Java 1.2 and Java 2 are the same thing. I think it was a marketing thing, but from that point forward in Java history, Java incremented by whole numbers, and they changed the name. It was now known as the Java 2 Standard Edition. Later releases were also Java 2, even though it was really the third and fourth, or fourth and fifth, depending on how you looked at it. The release numbers were 1.3 and 1.4. Then came 5. It was still Java 2 Standard Edition, but this version was 5.0. They added a ton of new functionality, so I think that's what they thought they could change the version numbers. Just in case you were paying attention, they still reported it as version 1.5. The 5.0 was a marketing thing. They just called it Java 5. When Java 6 came out, somebody finally noticed that, hey, there's still a 2 in the name. So they dropped the 2 and it became Java Standard Edition. It was the last major release by Sun Microsystems since they sold Java to Oracle. That was a pretty dark time for Java. People weren't sure what was going to happen to the language. 5 years and many broken promises later, Oracle finally released a new version of Java. They added lots of cool features to the language like new file I/O code, but they also dropped a lot of things like lambdas. And that brings us to the current version. So why did we go through all the history of that? The reason is it gets very confusing what you're trying to use for creating Java programs. JDK, Java Standard Edition, J2SE, they're all the same thing. The JDK is a superset of the Java Runtime Environment, JRE. So you only need to download the JDK. If you need to install the Java Development Kit on your machine, searching for Java Download might bring you to this page. This is not the download page you're looking for. Move along. This is just the JRE to run Java applications. You want something that looks more like this. This page was the download page when Java 8 release 40 was the latest and greatest. You can find the correct download for your operating system here. It may look different in the future, so if it does, just look for something similar. If you think you already have Java installed on your system, you can test that by typing java-version. You'll get a response similar to what I have here. Again, the version numbers are wonky. If you see 1.8, you've got the right version. That is Java 8. In this case, it says java 1.8.0_25. That means Java 8 release 25. Any release newer than this should work for this tutorial. The next concept to cover is Java keywords. Keywords are the words that are reserved for the Java language. They are the words you use to write Java programs. The list hasn't changed much since the language was created. Each of these keywords is case sensitive. This means they all use lowercase letters, and if you substitute a single capital letter, it will not be the keyword anymore. Java is a case sensitive language. For example, Boolean is not Boolean. The capital B makes it different. When we create variables and types later, you are strongly discouraged from using any of these words with a different case as your identifier. You can do it, but that's not a good idea. I should note that true, false, and null are not really keywords. They're what's called literal values. For example, 23 is a literal number. True is a literal Boolean value. We'll cover these more soon. They're included in the keyword list of do not use for names, and that's why they're in there. Go to is a bit unique. It's a keyword that's not used in the language. It's a silent jab at Microsoft's Visual Basic in other languages that used go to in their language. Using go to is considered bad practice for most programs. So Sun Microsystems made go to a keyword and then prevented anyone from ever using it. The last important term to cover for now is the Java IDE. IDE means Integrated Developer Environment. An IDE is a nice, slick user interface that you use to create Java programs. Java code files are ultimately text, but that doesn't mean you have to program in TextPad. You can use whatever IDE you like. The most popular IDEs are Eclipse and NetBeans. Both are free, which is why they are so popular. Now, if you come from a Visual Studio or Xcode background, these IDEs are going to be a rough ride. The IDEs are open source and don't have the polish other IDEs have. They're still light years better than typing programs in Notepad. We'll use NetBeans in the videos, but there's nothing that we do use that is particular to any IDE. You're free to use Eclipse or NetBeans. Thanks for watching this video. There's a quiz for this lesson on DGU.com if you'd like to gauge your understanding of this lesson. If you like the videos you're seeing, please let me know by liking the video and subscribing to the DGU channel on YouTube. I'd really appreciate it. If you have concerns or questions, please leave them in the comments below or on DGU.com. You can also let me know what topics you'd like to cover in future videos. On DGU.com, there's a poll on the main page voting for the next section of tutorials. Thanks for watching.